All right. I'm assuming that I'm streaming, but it is always difficult for me to know if I'm streaming without looking at the actual Epic Tavern stream and seeing it update. Welcome to a Friday dev stream for Epic Tavern. This is Tomo, and I'll be talking about elements of the game. Although last week on Friday, we had a bit of an interesting dev stream where I basically tried to pull together the basics for a new game idea. I mean, definitely wrapped in the context of an Epic Tavern-like game, and or maybe riffing on some of the features of Epic Tavern or some of the experiential ideals. Where is my Twitch window? And how do I find Epic Tavern? There we go. And what does it look like when I look at Epic Tavern? I wish I understood how to use this app better. Alright. It's funny. I see the ad for Twitch as I see myself starting to see myself visibly. And it says, welcome to the chat room. I can't... There is... Okay, we got zero watching now. Cool. I'm all alone. Maybe a little recap from last Friday's stream. It was this doc here where I kind of went through the process of devising a new game idea. And the idea was basically just one like a space management simulation game where you managed and ran maybe a large colony ship set in a galaxy that's gone through some severe cataclysm. And the gameplay mechanics focusing on building and improving your colony ship and serving the needs of the population that is your charge, and of course wandering the galaxy looking for little groups of people, alien races that are in need of your help and or occasionally in need of your violence, depending on the point of view. It was a fun little exercise. It's kind of an interesting exercise to take the concepts of Epic Tavern and try to apply them under different circumstances. Kind of the ways in which this did that was, rather than a tavern, you have a colony ship. And then for that colony ship, there's a bunch of kind of important native gameplay mechanics that would have to be necessary and present, where you can kind of expand and build and upgrade your colony ship. I mean, I think that be the kind of thing where any number of features could really work well. I could imagine some kind of Captain Forever remix meets reassembly style mechanics where you find new primitives that you can add to and or associate with your big ship. That's why it was called Big Ship. And, you know, build things like life support structures, things that grow food, things for people, you know, places for living quarters for people, maybe different living quarters depending on the species or race of aliens that you end up harboring or being a sanctuary for. Eventually, important things like an academy where you can have your own Starfleet and you start cultivating and building a new set of Epic Tavern style roster characters. And then those characters would ultimately end up as crew on ships that maybe you could design or add to your fleet as a result of meeting someone who's like a pirate or something. And then those characters, of course, there'd be a number of quests for you to go on, and those ships would fly into space with that objective. And along the way, they might run into random encounters very much like Epic Tavern. But the overall thrust of the experience for the player being much more one of I have the Battlestar Galactica and I have all these ships with people on them and I want to keep them safe, except with the maybe added kind of emotional pressure as well as kind of excitement that if there is a space battle that the actual damage you take might end up doing things like hitting the population of your colony ship, hurting life support. Now you're on a timetable to repair that life support, or else people start dying, or they're already dying, and you want to avoid them dying at a faster rate. Maybe there can be like a Pirates of the Caribbean with the squid face guy, Davy Jones, where you capture and or defeat enemy spaceships, take the crew and give them the opportunity to work for you or be killed. Who knows? Anyways, in terms of a recap, focusing on the last stream, I think that kind of gets the idea across. And so, kind of to Epic Tavern more specifically, as I've said in recent streams, I haven't had the opportunity to spend as much time as I'd like on Epic Tavern in recent weeks, and that has kind of gotten me in a position where I'm not as prepared to kind of talk about new and interesting things relating to Epic Tavern. This whole experience of mine where I was kind of basically soaking in Epic Tavern 24/7 puts me in a strong position to talk to you guys every week or multiple times a week. That said, in terms of a recap on Epic Tavern's development, obviously in recent times the build has taken on the features of this diagram, the kind of important skills refactor and increasing the number of encounter types. Again, the big reason for that is, one, to allow characters to connect to our narrative in a meaningful way. And what I mean by that is that depending on a character, their history, and their class, their ability to excel against a particular type of challenge needs to make sense or meet the expectations of the player. So their performance in different kinds of encounters, whether they be melee combat encounters or survival disaster encounters or mind puzzle encounters or social deceive encounters, that the class that you've sent on the party, it makes real good sense to you why they're good at this kind of chunk of written text as it pertains to the mechanics of our systems. One of those kind of important threads that is in progress right now is that our writer Sean is pulling together a big chunk of encounters in the new format. How would I say this best? We have exploring and making use of some of our important new capabilities. And to that effect, we kind of consolidate all of that into a single statement. In that single statement is compound encounters. The way the game worked before is there's a quest. That quest represents a destination on the map, and you put together a party, send them on that quest, and then they start making their way towards that destination. When they get to the destination, if they succeed or fail at the challenge at that destination, that'll determine success or failure in the quest. But the travel there, there are a lot of features wrapped around the actual experience of getting there. A lot of procedurally selected encounters that kind of create your own personal story, especially each of the characters that you're sending on these quests. They themselves kind of go through the sequence of challenges, largely depending on some of the randomly selected encounters that they face on the way to the quest's destination. And before the December 21st patch, we only had the four encounter types that you see in the middle of this diagram: combat, survival, social, and mind. And since then, we've added the 11 encounter types that you see in this intermediate ring. This middle ring here describes the new Epic Tavern encounter categories or encounter subtypes. And what they've really done is basically just divided the combat, survival, and social and mind encounter types into threes, except for combat, of course, which has been divided into two. The idea there is that the survival encounter type was basically too coarse a description. It can mean too many things. And so here I'll use social as an example to talk about this. In the past, our performer character or entertainer, not recalling the name of the class. I think it's Performer. The Entertainer, I think, is what it was called, actually. The Entertainer class had social skills that we thought, basically focus that character class on overcoming social challenges. However, we also have a class called Diplomat and Merchant, and they're also maybe centrally focused on survive on social as well. It's very obvious to anyone who reads just those names of those classes between Entertainer and Diplomat that they come from very different places. Their expertise results in the similar kinds of things being effective at the similar kinds of things. But in our old structure where social was the encounter type, there was no way to differentiate their effectiveness and therefore their kind of their reason for being or their strengths. And so with this change to the system where there are now social encounters of the befriend flavor, the deceive flavor, and the negotiate flavor, now we have a place for the diplomat to excel where the entertainer would not, and vice versa. Think of it as a way to make the origin stories of any given character more meaningful and connected to the encounters that they excel at overcoming. And naturally, the diplomat's good at negotiating, and the entertainer is good at befriend. And naturally, a spy-like character would be effective at deceive. The cut purse, the tricky, sneaky types, and some illusionist magical types are going to be more effective at deception and lying socially than they are at befriending or negotiating. And just to kind of speak to the kind of underlying narrative structure that drives our decisions, you can now imagine that a befriend encounter is a social challenge that requires you to successfully make another like you in order to overcome the challenge. And in many ways, that could be seen sort of as like the generic social encounter, but the way our system works doesn't quite support that exactly in that way. And so it's one of the three. The deceive becomes a social challenge that the character needs to successfully deceive the other in order to overcome the challenge. And negotiate ends up being one where, I don't know, depending on your perspective on what negotiating is really about, it's an opportunity for a character that has skills relating to coming to and or finding common ground in order to overcome a social challenge. So those are our three flavors of social encounters, and we have classes and skills. In this case, Befriend has the three skills of performance, partying, and customs associated with it. Deceive has the deceiving counter type, has spycraft, persuasion, and charm being a magical skill, and negotiate having leadership, diplomacy, and business as the skills that feed into those encounter subtypes. And mechanically speaking, or numerically speaking, the way the system works is that if you have skill points in any of the three skills that are in alignment with the encounter subtype, then you'll get double the skill power to associate. And of course, if it's not one of those encounter types, but it's still social, you get 100. You don't double your skill points, but they're still calculated in full. And of course, if you don't have any social skills whatsoever, any of the combat, survival, and mind skill points are not associated with, and/or don't increase the skill power contribution for the any of the other social encounters, or any of the social encounters. That said, there's a twist on this system. And I will bring up the skill specializations diagram that I brought up many times in the past. Each of those skills that you see here, all 36 of this outer ring, three-ish, combat notwithstanding, three skills for every encounter type that are worth double. When you put 10 points into a given skill, you are offered the choice of three skill specializations. And so this example uses a mind subtlety skill called illusion and describes three of its skill specializations. So you put your 10th point into illusion, and then you're given a choice between trick, magic hide, and hide from combat. And at this point now, it's an opportunity for the player to kind of start min-maxing and customizing their characters, hopefully thinking about the way they configure groups into parties to tackle the challenges of the road and the encounters that they find along the way. Many of these Skill specializations will be encounter abilities, or things we call event actions, that allow them to trade some of the character's spirit to execute a power move of some sort. And in the case of Trick, well, in the case of Magic Hide, if you have a Mind Subtlety encounter, of which Illusion is aligned with, and therefore worth double, if you use the event action of Magical Hide, at the cost of a certain amount of spirit, you'll get a significant percent bonus to your skill points. And that'll make you more powerful when dealing with Mind Subtlety encounters. Another one of the skill specialization choices is called Trick, and it allows you to use an ability during social deceive encounters and be able to kind of maybe transfer some of your mind skill points to accomplishing a social deceive encounter. And finally, in this case, there is Hide from Combat, the third skill specialization that, if you choose, gives you an ability while traveling on the road. To reduce the incidence of combat encounters. So all of these things have their uses, and depending on what you've been doing in the game and some of the holes that you want to fill and or things that you want to double down on, you'll make your choice and be able to use these abilities going forward. Just as a note with the way the system is intended to work, every 10 points you put into these skills will give you the choice again. And although probably in the first revision of skill specializations, which is technically the patch that we're in the midst of working on currently, you'll be able to either pick a new specialization and add it to your capabilities, and or rank up an existing skill specialization to level 2, to level 3, to level 4, at which point it'll basically be a more powerful version of itself and probably cost marginally more spirit as well. Of course, Hide from Combat as an adventure action. Just a second here. Let me get my game up to date. I am considering whether I play a little bit of Epic Tavern to show you some of the new stuff that Eric's been working on. A lot of UI refactors and resolving issues with traveling on the world map. As we're getting deeper into creating nuance and interactivity while questing, we're tearing up the pipes in a lot of spots in the game. I think that gives you a decent context for kind of the state of development so far. Like I was saying, Sean's been making a bunch of encounters that are very interesting. They make use of a feature that we call, or a tool that we call Stage Trigger. It allows us to, at the end of any piece of any encounter's results, define what is the specific next encounter that will occur. And the kind of business end of that functionality is that if I come upon a locked door, for example, the encounter can be a mind puzzle encounter where the door needs to be unlocked. And if you succeed, the success results trigger the next encounter to dwell upon what you find on the other side of that unlocked door. And then for failure, there may be no stage trigger identified, and you just go on, you pass on. It's an encounter where there was a locked door, you failed to unlock it, and then you moved on. And then, however, if you successfully unlocked it, then you got to see what was on the other side of the door. It could be as simple as just a brick of text, or a little block of text that describes what you find on the other side of the door. Maybe it will give you some gold. Maybe there's someone sitting there eating breakfast going, "Why are you walking into my house?" Or it could be a combat encounter. The moment you open that unlocked door, that someone charges you and there's a fight. And that said, the block of text that would describe someone being upset that you walked into their home, there's nothing stopping that from being a social deceive encounter where you need to now trick that person into thinking that you're here to check the levels on their gas meter because you work for LADWP or something. And then if you fail, they catch you in the lie, and then it turns into a combat encounter. And each of these situations represent a encounter and a success or failure, producing different results and leading you down kind of a compound encounter that has multiple steps and can make use of multiple different skill sets. In fact, there is one that Sean has been writing up recently that kind of represents the kind of pinnacle of his thoughts with respect to these compound encounters that gets very complicated. I'm not going to get into too much detail with it right now because I don't necessarily want to spoil it just yet. But as those encounter types come together more and more, I think it's a great thing to share, especially on these dev streams. Okay. Let's see here. Let's see what we got going here. So how do you see who's in the chat again? It's like the button changed again. Oh, it went back to what it used to be. There was like, I could have sworn that on the Twitch client, I would see there was a new button that showed up to see who's in the chat. And it's gone back to what I remember it from before. It's interesting. I wonder if that had actually to do with the difference between the browser version of Twitch versus the what used to be Curse client. It's kind of weird remembering back when there was Thoughtbot for World of Warcraft, and we'd look at that to understand what it is we were doing, because maybe the game itself wasn't as clear as it could be. That transitioned into Wowhead. There was a curse gaming of some sort, and that got its own client, and it became the thing I used to manage my mods, and then that got bought by Twitch, and Twitch was owned by Amazon. And now the Twitch client is this source of free games, by the way, as a result of being a Twitch Prime member, which is the same as being an Amazon Prime member. It's a little bit of an aside, but I mean, I have like 75 games that I've gotten through Twitch Prime, and some of them are quite good. I have Battle Chef Brigade, Cultist Simulator, Darksiders 1, which I was a huge fan of that game. I thought that game was so good. Dear Esther, For the King, Hotline Miami, and Hotline Miami 2, Hyperlight Drifter, a lot of good stuff. And it's, you know, it's a strange situation we're in these days in terms of platforms and ways to get access to games. A lot of services trying to boost their perceived value by making almost like a subscription available. I think that loosely speaking, that's what Epic Game Store is trying to do. You know, hey, just visit us every couple weeks and we'll give you a free game, and eventually something will be available that you want. And I know there's a lot of controversy wrapped around the Epic Game Store, and all I can tell you guys is that competition against Steam, however much I love Steam, and I'm a huge supporter of and fan of Valve and Steam, it is healthy for the overall marketplace for there to be competition. And it is beneficial both to the consumers as well as us developers. It creates an environment that has more options, more choices, room to suit the needs or the nature of one developer versus another, and definitely suit the needs of one user versus another. So it's interesting. Obviously, nothing's been resolved. There's definitely a lot of public discourse about the issue, and maybe some amount of arguing, maybe the occasional yelling that occurs. But the only thing we know for sure is that things are changing a bit, and we'll see how that all plays out. It's been exciting so far to watch. Alright, so I think we've been looking at this skill specialization diagram long enough, maybe for like the last 6 months on and off. Maybe I'll take a brief moment to kind of talk a little bit about some of the data format and implementation pipelines that we make use of in Epic Tavern. I occasionally go over some of these details and just talk about how crazy it is, how kind of complex our tool pipeline is to get information into the game or content into the game. That is largely the byproduct of us implementers feeling comfortable with that complexity. I'm not trying to say that this is how these tools should be. Generally speaking, the more work you do on tools, the better, and inevitably you do save time. But sometimes it's hard to do that when the thing that you're working on itself is fundamentally a exploration rather than an execution. And I think those of you that are acquainted with Epic Tavern, it is fairly obvious that it is far more an exploration of ideas than the execution of a standing concept. Our aspiration is to bring together the ideas of custom and procedural storytelling, to bring emergent narrative as felt as authored by the player, and deliver it to the hands of any player, not just the kind of player that's willing to put a crap load of time into learning the complexities of a lot of the games that do tend to instill this sense of player-authored narrative. You know, the games like Dwarf Fortress and even Football Manager, Crusader Kings, all these games are extraordinarily complicated games. Games that I love and are, in their ways, magnificent, really. But very hard to deny that very difficult to get into, very difficult to understand. It takes it's like you have to do a self-taught class in how to play the game just to play the game. And that isn't everybody's cup of tea, and I don't blame anybody for not wanting to do that. However, in my experience with those games, I found some wonderful experiences. Amazing stories that existed entirely because of my choices, and with details and nuance that just can't happen without this kind of multiple interacting systems complexity that a lot of these games have. The only difference with Epic Tavern is that right from the get-go, we were always under the impression that we tried to make it available for anybody to play, that you don't have to understand the system, you don't need to know all the rules, that any unsuspecting user can stumble their way through the game and get an emergent, procedurally influenced, player-authored narrative. And for those of you out there, ultimately it's up to you, or it depends on whether it worked out that way for you, more so than whether I want you to feel that. We have some evidence that it's worked out that way for some. And of course the game is still very much in development. Oh, and in pertinent news to Epic Tavern and our evolution and moving forward and trying to get more notoriety and trying to get more visibility, we are one of the PAX 10 winners. And so at the end of this, oh my god. Like in 8 days, I'm going to PAX West with four of the other team members, and we're going to show Epic Tavern as one of the PAX 10 winners. Really, really excited about it. Really grateful that we won and we get this opportunity. And we'll get one more chance or another opportunity to show the game to the public. We did have an opportunity to do that last year at MomoCon in Atlanta. And that was a great experience. Some of you we got to know there. And so to continue kind of with our tool pipeline, what we're looking at here, actually, let's move over to this tab. So one, big Google spreadsheet. Wall of text, tons of entries, overwhelmingly noisy, infinite number of letters kind of block here. This sheet, and if you look across the bottom, you can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, ten, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21 tabs in this Google spreadsheet. And all 21 of those tabs relate to our quests and the encounters that you can run into, or the challenges you can encounter while traveling on the road. And so it might seem like it's fairly complicated, and it is, and it probably more complicated than it needs to be. But that's one of the things that happens when you build a system bit by bit and kind of explore. And so this one tab is the quests tab. And in this quests tab, we have this row for the ID, which allows us to have a unique identifier for each quest, quest title, a quest chain title, because many of our quests are in quest chains, and sometimes I give them quest chain data anyways, so that in the quest chain area, you can see kind of, you can get additional information. One of the ways we like to think about the storytelling in Epic Tavern is that there's like an onion of information. We would love it if you cared about every single layer of that onion all the way to its core. And by this onion analogy, the outermost layer of the onion is the most blatant surface level elements of the storytelling. And maybe one could say in this case then a quest and its goal is the kind of outermost layer of that onion. But even then, you may not know that goal in detail unless you read all the blocks of text. And let's say you're not much of a reader, and you're not that interested in those words. There's like a lot of words there, and you're not really accustomed to games forcing you to read, and so you don't. And we don't have a problem with that. In fact, we still care about the play experience for those who don't read, and that's why the actual, when you're questing, there's this kind of party avatar, like a helmet with horns, and it walks its way to the destination, and it kind of spits out this iconographic representation of the story at its kind of mechanical level. This kind of encounter is happening. Oh, you failed. Oh, and now you're moving further, and this another kind of encounter happened, and you succeeded. Oh, and you got gold, so gold flew out of the avatar, and a little chest appeared, and a little sword with an upward arrow showed up because someone gained a skill point. These kinds of visual elements become the high-speed kind of mechanical shorthand for what's happening in the story. Of course, there's more than that. More than that is happening because the specific words that we've written for these stories allow us to get into some detail about things that generally game systems can't really support, except in our case that text display is kind of an essential part of the storytelling that we're trying to pull together. Now, if that outermost layer, though, is a quest and its objective, it's kind of more than that actually becomes that the quest and its objective, how does that fit into maybe a chapter, a multi-chapter story? Is this first one we go and we talk to the store owner and the store owner says there was a thief that stole this really valuable thing to me and it's something that was very dear to my child who died in an accident. And I'd really like if you got it back, and I'd give you this reward if you did. And then you go to the destination, and then you look around because you're a good detective, or you're smart, or you're good at social. And then you find out a clue, and then after that clue, you complete that quest, and that triggers the next quest, which allows you start snooping down the path of that clue. And then thing after thing after thing happens, you find out the kids actually faked their death, and they stole it because they liked it. And then there's, depending on the choices you make, they are reunited happily, or you go back to the parents and go like, yeah, you know, we never figured out what was going on. Or maybe the kid's like, actually, you know, maybe I ought to give it back to them. I didn't realize they'd be so upset. Any of those things become possible, and the details in the text is what makes that story, the nuance of that story, clear to the player. But if you didn't read that text, what you would still get is a series of challenges for your party. And speaking of those challenges, our quests are comprised of a destination and a challenge at that destination. Oh, Catfish Water Dancer says, which puzzle piece does the quest add to, as the full picture isn't clear until the final piece fits? Yes, exactly. And that said, that's not necessarily to say that's how we always want to be. I mean, I think we are okay with it being super clear. God, it's weird. I see my own portrait on the computer screen, and since it's flipped, I keep wanting to move my head this way because this side of my shoulder looks narrower than the other side of my shoulder. But then I move my head this way trying to do it, and then it gets shorter, even worse. It's a weird little mental distraction for me. Anyway, so these are the this tab is the stages tab. And, well, just let me see if I can wrap up here. So this quest title, quest chain. This data here is the quest category, and right now we only have two quest categories. Zero means it's a tavern quest, and one means it's, oh god, that's not true. Zero means it's a story quest, which really means just not a tavern quest. And the tavern quests are all things that relate to upgrades or improvements to the tavern, basically. Or in a quest chain that leads to. This quest chain thing is the identifier, the unique ID that is associated with the quest chain title. My phone just made a really loud, weird sound. I guess my leg is sweaty. That was Google activating, Google Voice activating. That's the thing is, where I'm streaming from is upstairs in my house. It's a warm-ish summer. Weird. And of course heat rises, so it's getting kind of warm up here. And I guess the way our phones work with their capacitive screens, a bit of moisture. Now the screen feels like it's being touched. And I guess for me, it means I'll do more pocket calls with people when I'm upstairs and it's hot. So we have this field here called patron info, and this is a great example of features that we tried to implement that didn't quite work out, and our philosophical approach to how we deal with those things when they don't. So patron intro was a field that would allow us to put a custom statement by the character who gives you the quest. Mostly the way things work is the quests become randomly assigned to characters in the tavern for that day, and at some point that quest availability icon shows up over their head, and then they'll talk to you. Usually, there's a phrase that characters use where they're like, hey, I'd like you to have this quest. And it's just there's like maybe 10 or 12 things that they say, like, hey, there's something I'd like to talk to you about, or I heard these rumors, and but some of these quests, we thought it might be interesting if the way they were introduced was very custom to the actual quest itself. And once the quest actually becomes visible, that's when you see the briefing text, and some of its specific context is available for the player to understand. And then we thought that ramping in with a custom statement for the character would be something we were interested in. For a number of factors that didn't quite work out the way we wanted to, I think it actually does work. We just haven't found enough context or priority to make heavy use of it. But as you can see here, like the muck attack quests can start with, what's that drunken idiot yelling about this time? And that's what he would say. And then you'd get the quest. And then the quest would have that pop up and it would say, I swear I'm not crazy, shouts a tipsy patron. Others have seen him too. Giant globs climbing out of the swamp and liquefying everything they touch. One turned my poor Martha into mush. I'll never find a better horse. And then you accept the quest in sort of strange fashion. Our game doesn't really allow you to not accept the quest. These are the debrief fail and debrief succeed once you've come back from finishing the destination challenge. And then this level column describes kind of the difficulty of the quest. It'll be of higher or lower level relative to your roster's levels, depending on what we assign here. Medium kind of being in the middle, of course, easy being easier, and hard being harder. Given by character, another thing that's a feature that we were interested in, that being yes or no, there were going to be a number of quests that could be either activated through like a help wanted board, and through a number of alternate mechanisms. None of those alternate mechanisms we've had a chance to kind of get into the game, so the only way you can get a quest is through another character right now. Oh, I guess. Yeah, basically. And so as a result, every single one of the quests in this field has is set to true. But that said, one of the elements of the philosophy of this approach is we keep the field because we might be able to get around to making use of it. And so when the time comes for these other types of quests, these other types of quest unlocking, this field is sitting there, ready, and waiting to go. There's this tier. And here's another side effect of working on a game for a long time and trying to pull together a bunch of features and explore. I don't even remember what tier is supposed to be. It was a long time ago. Tier is original launch, early access field that we haven't used really since. Catfish also says, ah, that Mage College, always dumping out experiments that aren't quite dead. Yeah, it's our little joke about industry and pollution. This field here describes the delayed unlock turn count. So when the quest becomes unlocked under the hood, this allows us to set a certain number of turns before it becomes available. So that way you could have something like you meet someone on the road and just meeting this person unlocks a quest and they said, you know what, I'll come by next week. And then we set the delay to be 5 turns or something. And then 5 days later, quest shows up, the guy shows up, you know, whatever, however we end up handling that. And then these last two ones are pre-get expiration time. This one is strange, where we wanted the power if you unlock the quest, but you never accepted it from anybody. How many turns would have to pass before it became unavailable? For the most part, that doesn't really help the game in its current format, but that may become more and more relevant as we have more quests that become repeatable and or come up intermittently. And post-get expiration time. It's all set to 100, which is just practically forever. But the idea would be like, hey, I have a special at my brewery in the southern Bayor area, and I'd love it if you guys would come by and taste the beer and tell me what you think. And you have a social encounter to go visit the brewery and talk to the person that came and visited who maybe works there. But the special's only going on for a week, so if you don't go on that quest in the next 7 days, it expires. And basically, though, right now, you don't go on a quest for 100 days, it will technically expire, and if you were to do something like that early enough in the game, it may very well cause some pretty severe problems in the way we unlock quests. We do want to get this under control and 100% bulletproof, even though, practically speaking, the likelihood of anyone getting half a dozen turns into the game, then advancing through 100 turns, having those quests then expire, and then kind of being stuck, although possible, is not probable. Anyways, moving on to the stages. These are all the encounters. So if the quest, think of the quest in the logic of Epic Tavern as a wrapper for a single custom encounter that has been set to be in a particular location, and that the wrapper is keeping track of that one encounter, and if you succeed, it calls itself a success. And if it calls itself a success, kind of in the logic of this sheet, or this tab on this spreadsheet, it'll trigger one of these quest unlock conditions, and then another quest will be unlocked, and then that'll unlock another quest, etc., etc. But none of those quests can happen without an encounter at the end, and on your way to that destination, random encounters are selected and put in front of the party. And so this represents our current list of encounters, of which I think there are 1,200 something? Is that how it goes? Or it's more than that? Yeah, it's more than that. Oh, you're right. No, last I heard is 2050. I think we're at we're not quite yet. Yeah, we're at 2032 encounters. To be fair, each of the quests, of which there are currently about maybe 600, they do need their own encounter at the end, and it has to be a totally unique encounter. So of these 2,000 encounters, it's only really 1,400 of them that are not the not directly associated with the present list of quests. And the data here gets a little more intense in that there is a setup, and that's what you see when the encounter starts. Then you get to roll your characters and use your abilities and try to get as much skill power as you can. If your skill power exceeds the difficulty, then you will get a positive result, which is this one here. Now, that positive result, however, when there's a positive result, right now the way the rules work is any given positive result has a 10% chance of being a quirky positive. And what we were trying to shoot for here was that there's a positive and negative result, and each of those negative and positive results also have a kind of quirky, funny, more interesting, one that appears more uncommon result as well. And I think as we go forward, we're starting to recognize that maybe we're going to want to use the quirky and quirky positive and quirky negative results a little bit more like critical success and critical failure, and have kind of escalating rewards and use language to say that you guys did something special. So I wouldn't be surprised if you see that adaptation to the existing system.
This field here
can fail. It's kind of an interesting one. It describes any encounter that, if it fails, will mean failure for the quest. And so, for the most part, all of our encounters that are at the destination for a given quest generally are can fail true. And then any of the encounters that are meant to, you're meant to pass through, stuff like the procedurally selected encounters along the way, those are meant to be not fail, or it doesn't matter if they fail. They won't fail the quest. Another kind of failed experiment was to have failure text here associated with certain encounters that are related to quests, so that you get a block of text right then and there when you fail to tell you, hey, you know, even though you're not going to really get finishing or completion messaging about this quest until you get home, when you've actually completed the encounter and if you failed, we'd like to let you know right now that you did fail the quest, and wrap a little text around that to get you to understand better what's happening. It largely didn't work, and that's not to say that it couldn't, but it would take some more work for us to kind of sufficiently modify the experience to kind of accommodate understanding that failure better. This column is for the difficulty of our encounters. As you can see, this all looks like 0.5s. That just means it ends up being what we expect. Back in the day, that meant like a level 3 encounter was going to be 20 difficulty. But as we go forward and as we tune the difficulty of given encounters, what we really like to see is if you read an encounter and it sounds hard, that it is hard. And if you read that encounter and it sounds easy, then it is easy. Also, more importantly, you could easily glance at the difficulty of an encounter and, as a byproduct, kind of get the feeling of its difficulty. So maybe you're not reading the details, but you see a social negotiating encounter, and it looks real hard, and you don't even know. You're not going to read the words. And then there's this hard negotiating encounter that then transitions into, after failure, into a melee fight. And, you know, now it's starting to make sense. It doesn't matter what the specific words are. You know that there was some diplomacy, and that ended in people beating each other up or trying to kill each other. The only point being there that the iconographic shorthand for what's happening in the story, there's nothing stopping that from being just as rich and interesting a depiction of a story's rhythm and some flavor information about the context of what's going on, with or without those words. Although we do believe strongly that those words add quite a bit. Now, these four columns here, they represent the they represent procedural damage. So, you know, some of our combat encounters, I mean, a number of our encounters, they have very custom, specifically described damage that characters will take. But we want to make a transition where the majority of these encounters that that you run into, not even majority, we'll just say a lot, as many of these encounters as we can handle, we'd like for them to be compound encounters and have multiple steps and have multiple interconnected steps. Let's go on. Now, these four procedural damage is basically constructed from a chance, the base chance for hit point damage to occur on this stage. And as you can see here, for the most part, they're all empty. or zero. A lot of the stuff we wrote before wasn't necessarily thinking about a procedural damage system. It was thinking about like a specific damage experience where you have a survival physical feat encounter and someone gets their leg pinned under a falling log and some strong guy's got to lift it up to get that person free. And then if you fail, maybe there's some terrible consequence that happens to that character's leg. And here we have this P scaling entries, both one and one. But what these do is they increase or decrease the magnitude of the damage that gets thrown around in the party. So if you're to like really increase the height, the size of these numbers, and then also increase these as well, you'll get a lot more damage. This HP spread and SP spread, these are enumerated drop downs, which allow us to kind of set the nature of the damage taken by the party. And over here we have a move cost that's been kind of translated into enumerated values that describe in English or in language how far or how long it takes to complete that encounter. Permafail and permapass, kind of old, outdated fields here. Equipment, I think it was ultimately a matter of equipment requirements or you need to wear this piece of gear, but we don't make much use of that right now. Let's see, what does this say? Equipment rack, interesting. Oh, I have itchy bug bite on my ankle. Not looking great. So can permafail and permapass, it's like it relates to when you're on a quest, if you fail it, will you get to try again? And the answer for Epic Tavern is sometimes yes and sometimes no. Same goes for Can Permapass. Oh, I get it. That's funny. Sorry. Little joke there. So, this equipment field, unused. It used to be a way for us to identify that a piece of equipment needs to be present. And we're still totally on board with doing that, but in order to do that, we're going to have to support some custom UI elements. Epic Excel, a primer. Yeah. We do a lot of storytelling through these Excel sheets. But yeah, that encounter, well, that one really is deprecated, or it's unnecessary now, because we just have other ways to message the player that that certain equipment is necessary and or certain equipment rewarded. And finally, the stage type. And here you can kind of see a listing of the types of encounters in the game. And that's just the 11 or so that are in the that diagram before. Now, generally speaking, most of the data in the game isn't that intense, and there's not as much data kind of like keep a finger on. And a lot of these other files kind of end up being kind of organizational and support. It's kind of like exclusive quests here. Whoa. So I'm looking at these exclusive quests and their descriptions there. I think I might have just gotten a little bit of sleepiness there. I think the heat upstairs is heavily contributing to that. I don't think I've ever done that on a stream though before. Maybe I should be drinking coffee. So, part of the Epic Tavern quest system is that occasionally you get these very straightforward choose-your-own-adventure-like options. And so, like in this case here, we have the top line ends up being, having accidentally uncovered a hostage situation by digging into a nearby building's cellar, the heroes have little time to decide how to approach. And in this case, it's the one where Marga Shacklebuster, you find her brother, I think that's how the story goes. And you get to choose between quest 430, well, I think it might be quest leg, but quest 430, 431, and 433. And then it'll display the briefing for each of those quests. 430, 431. And so those three quests in this case are Bound and Determined, Neighborhood Watch, and Revenge is a Dish Best Served Now. And so the briefings for each of those are, with no time for a cautious approach, the heroes decide to smash through the wall and rescue the dwarf. That's the let's do this choice. The next choice is deciding that playing it safe is the best move. The heroes opt to remain in hiding and watch the hostage situation to see what happens. A more sneaky, possibly smarter approach. And finally, the third choice. The slavers have gone back upstairs, creating an opportunity for the heroes to break through the rest of the tunnel wall and rescue famous slaver hunter Marga Shacklebuster. And that gives you just a basic idea of kind of the choose-your-own-adventure nature of your chances at selecting specific quests. So if you think about kind of the all the tools at our disposal for kind of branching stories. One, from encounter to encounter, we can tell kind of a compound set of things. Like, oh, hey, our goal was to negotiate the release of someone kidnapped with a bunch of bandits. And so there's a social negotiate encounter. Actually, we'll start with something like that. As you walk up to the situation, it's a mind subtlety encounter to see if you can notice anything that are out of place. And if you succeed at that encounter, you'll see that there are people hiding in an alley on the other side of the street. And that's kind of making you suspicious. And in doing so, it changes the nature of the next encounter, which is the social negotiate encounter. So now we have two social negotiate encounters. One that we play out if you didn't notice the people across the street in the alley, and another if you did. And if you did, maybe, you know, we take whatever liberties we want to in the way we tell that story or write that story. It could go down as we describe the heroes saying, hey, you know, we noticed that you guys see what looks like an ambush across the street. What's up with that? And then they go, ha ha ha, we're just wanting to be sure that we're safe or that nothing goes wrong or we don't get into any trouble or you didn't send any, or even in case you brought people along with you. And or what they say is, it looks like you caught us, and then a fight starts. But then those two choices could be based on success or failure in that social encounter. And so it's kind of like, and that can continue on and on. So then the social encounter goes wrong, you get into a fight. You get into the fight and you win, you get the person who's kidnapped. But let's say, keep extending the story. You get in the fight and you win, and it's in that moment you find out the person who was kidnapped is actually part in on the deal, and they run. And then it turns into a survival exploration encounter where you're running after them and trying to catch up. And if you fail that, they get away. And now you're left with a mind subtlety encounter to see if you can track them down, even though they're out of sight now. If you succeed at that, you get a clue. And then it gives you another encounter that, you know, if you succeed in that encounter, then you get back to the person who was kidnapped and you can question them. And then that itself becomes a negotiate or a deceive encounter. You want to trick them about something to get them to divulge information that you're looking for. And or it's a befriend encounter. You're like, hey, you know, your boss wants you back and we don't have to tell him that you set this all up. Why don't we just pretend that the whole thing went well and you're going to go back? And if you don't befriend them, they're like, hell no, and something else happens. Suffice to say, at a very tactical encounter-to-encounter level now, we have all the power we need to kind of tell a detailed, multifaceted challenge or sequence of challenges for the party. And that's kind of at the micro level or at the tactical level. And then, of course, at the macro level of the quests themselves, of course, we've always had this exclusive choice functionality. So we have this sequence of quests that one thing unlocks another, and success or failure in a quest might unlock a different quest than another quest. Why does my computer do that? Every now and then, different tabs come into focus, and they've been minimized, and then they become maximized, or they show up, they get restored. If anyone knows about that kind of behavior, I've been seeing it lately. I bet I have some bad malware or something. They can spy on my stream. Oh, and some people have, there's some questions here or some statements. Catfish says, oh, 80 arrives just in time for the end of the stream. Absolutely, it is 5:01. Yeah, and Catfish mentions that this this basement quest, which is really about you expanding your wine cellar, but turns into finding Marga Shacklebuster. And Marga Shacklebuster is one of the characters that can join your roster and come to the tavern. It's something that we like doing, is kind of like hiding. It's like Easter eggs, but it's really the whole experience is one where we want to kind of create that experience where you don't know what's going to happen next. You're moving down the timeline. You're making your choices, but stuff happens, and it can happen under all manners of circumstances. So characters can be unlocked by almost anything, but very frequently unlocked as a result of a particular result in a quest. But just to kind of finish that, and I think with this I'll probably wrap up the design stream. Apologies if it's a bit too much of a recap on things from the past. But it is interesting. I don't get tired of re-explaining all these systems, and inevitably when I do re-explain them, it is from new vectors, I guess. But the Choose Your Own Adventure choices that you make allow you to pick multiple choices for your perspective, and then success or failure, branching the unlocking of different quests, allows the performance of the party, and therefore your choices for bringing together the right tool set for the encounter type to also have an influence on how the story unfolds at the strategic level or at the chapter level. You can think of the encounters as paragraphs in a chapter, and the quest itself as the chapter. Or pages, maybe. Pages to chapters. And then sometimes quest chains, which are multiple chapter books, lead to other quest chains, which could be book series. And sometimes all these quest chains all relate to each other, so they're kind of books in the same universe, I guess. There are a number of analogies we like using, and we don't restrict ourselves to any one particular analogy. I think we like this idea that if you can describe your thing with many different analogies, then many different perspectives can see it for what it is to them, I guess. And I guess with that little bit of esoteric whatever, I'll bring the dev stream to a close, and I will be talking to you guys next time. Tomorrow at 4 might be tricky for Thursday's dev chat. I'm sure you guys have noticed these last few weeks I have been very busy with some non-Epic Tavern project related things, and so that's kind of made my my schedule a little less predictable. But I feel high confidence that I'll be doing the Friday dev stream as well. And maybe this time, I think maybe I'll share more specifically some of the encounters. Maybe I'll even use it as an opportunity to implement the compound encounters that Sean's put together. Bye, guys. Oh, wait, let me do the... busy is good, but it is a lot, and it is distracting. And my heart definitely lies in Epic Tavern. So, throw me an 07 if you're lurking and you want me to give you a shout out. And thank you so much. Well, thank you to our moderator, 80, and to Catfish Water Dancer, Commander Root Lurks, The Wrong House, and Will Dragon You. Thanks for coming, and I will see you guys next time.